Hello and welcome everybody. So this is section 8, and the aim of this section is to fill some gaps in the previous presentation. Namely, both for regression and for kernel density estimation, we had these tuning parameters. This was the bandwidth for kernel-based methods, and the number k, the size of the neighbourhood for k nearest neighbour regression. And we have no really good methods yet for choosing k and h, the size and the bandwidth. And in this section, we'll learn how to do this using cross-validation, and that will lead to methods which are useful in practice and which are widely used. Okay, so let's have a look. So first, I want to explain the idea behind cross-validation. So assume for a second we are looking at regression, and we have our estimates m hat h of x for all x, and that is approximately equal to the unknown model mean x, and we need to choose h to make this fit as good as possible. So the question is, how can we do that? Well, if that's this, we don't know the mean, so we can't use this. But what we have is the yi, which are samples from a distribution centered around the mean. So what one could attempt to do is, one could attempt to minimize the residual sum of squares as a function of h, which would be some I from 1 to n m hat h at the point xi minus the observation at this point, so minus yi squared. And you will remember in linear regression, the least squares method was doing exactly that. So there m hat h was replaced with a straight line. And there this method works. And the point I want to make here is for kernel regression or these non-parametric models, this method does not work. And the reason is that m hat h, this value, converges to y if h goes to 0. So h is the size of the neighborhood we are using for averaging, in a sense at least. And if that goes to 0, we only see points very close, and in the limit we just see the sample at xi, and so the average will only include yi. And then what we get m hat h of xi will converge to yi as h goes down to 0. And then, in a sense, that's good, but that also means we can make that thing as small as we want to by choosing h small, and the optimization problem, the answer will always be the smaller h is, the better. So the solution to that, if we use this flawed method, would be h equals 0 is the optimal choice, or h very small. And the problem is, say, if we think about kernel density estimation for a moment, if we have our xi here, then the kernel density estimate for very small h just has very sharp peaks at every sample, and for small h they don't overlap. So that thing very much looks just like, I don't know, the empirical distribution maybe that will tell us just where are the samples. So that's not really smoothing out the data, and that will not give us a reasonable estimation of the density. So this take h as small as possible is bad advice there. And similarly for regression, we have data here, then what we really want would be a line which goes somewhere in the middle. But for small h, I just wrote here, the estimate goes to yi as h goes to 0 at the point xi. So what that means is we would get a regression line here which goes up and down and up and down and up and down. So that turns into a very wiggly line. So that here is for small h, a very wiggly line. And I write good h here, this straight line is what we want. And again, h close to 0 is not the answer of this problem. So that approach, minimizing residual sum of squares, does not work. And we can immediately see from this picture what goes wrong. Namely, it overfits. It goes too close to the data, and it's modeling the noise in the data rather than the mean. And what the solution is rather simple, and that's what's called cross-validation. Namely, let me just copy that. So we have h, and now that will be the real one, is some I from 1 to n. And here we take a modified estimator. I write m hat h I. I'll explain in a second. That thing at point xi minus yi squared. And the idea is we can prevent it from overfitting by just using here a model which did not know yi when it was fitted. So what we do is the model with index I up here is the model which was fitted to all the data except for the pair xi yi. So where m hat hi is fitted without using the sample xi yi. Good. And now it cannot overfit anymore. It cannot overfit to yi because it doesn't know yi. The fitting happened without using xi yi. So that is one way of resolving the problem. That approach here will give a much better result than what we have just seen previously. Good, so that's how it's done. And that is a special instance of a method called cross-validation. I mentioned this already. And the cross, I believe, is meaning the validation goes across the divide of the values fitted and the values where we test, and there is a gap in the middle. That's my interpretation. I'm not quite sure whether that's accurate. And that method is a bit expensive, or for large n, very expensive. Namely, you see what we need to do is here we need to fit n different models. So this n models of size n minus 1. And there are ways to make it cheaper. I want to just quickly mention this. There is also k-fold cross-validation. And there, instead of fitting n separate models, one fits only k models. And the idea is one takes the data. So here is I going from 1 up to n. And one splits this into k subsamples. So that's subsample 1, I do them in circles, and 2 up to k. And we know from what we have just seen what we can do. So if we fit a model without using subsample 1, so model I is model fit without using subsample I. With what we have just seen, we know that thing can be used to assess quality of fit for the xi, yi, so for the samples which are within the subsample. And you see every xi, yi is in one of these subsamples. So for each of them, there is exactly one model which we can use for assessing them. And that is always, like I wrote it here, the model which was fitted without using the data here. And this is slightly inferior to the previous approach. So here we fitted n models, so that is n-fold cross-validation, if you want it so. We split the data into n groups of size 1. And the downside here is you have now less data to fit your model because you have not removed only one of them, but you have removed one case of the data. So the sample size you use for model fitting is a bit smaller. But in exchange, what you get is you need to fit fewer models so it gets faster. So sometimes this is needed. But if you can, I would recommend always use that. That is called leave one out cross-validation. And that, because it uses more data for fitting the models, should get better results. Good, let's just have a quick look how we can use this for these three types of models we have considered. So first, I just wrote that, so kernel regression smoothing. There we had two methods. We had Nadaraya-Watson estimator and local polynomial regression, but it's both the same. It's like I just wrote, so choose h to minimize the thing I just wrote. So residual sum of squares in the sense, sum over all samples, then do m hat h fitted without using sample I at point xi minus yi squared. And that m hat h I could be computed either using the Nadaraya-Watson estimator or local polynomial regression. Either way will work. Then the next method we have considered, that was in section 7, we had k nearest neighbor regression. And that is exactly the same, only now the smoothing parameter was called k. So what we do is minimize rk, which is sum I from 1 to n, m hat I, and I think I just called it m hat I k at the point xi minus yi squared, where that is of course the k nearest neighbor estimate computed without using sample I. And I've not spoken about how to find the minimum so far, and there is no theory to go with this. You just use a computer and do numerical minimization. And in this case, that's easy because k is discrete, so just plug in values for k from 1 to 3 and so on up to some upper limit and compute it for each k and choose the smallest one. Here h is continuous, so there are infinitely many values, but you can use some, I don't know, maybe a grid search, and then from the best grid point you do some downhill gradient algorithm or something. Good. The slightly more difficult bit is kernel density estimation, and there are two ways one can do that. One would be to use maximum likelihood estimation. So there's the likelihood for a given bandwidth, given a sample of x values, there are no y values in kernel density estimation, that since the samples are assumed to be independent, it's just the product of the densities. So that's product I from 1 to n, and densities under the model are our estimated densities, so f hat h of xi. And that, again, would not work. The answer here would be one should h as small as possible, but it does work if one uses the leave one out, I write LOO for leave one out, kernel density estimator, which is computed again without using xi. Good, so that works, and there is only a practical thing. These density values can be small, and if you multiply 100 numbers which are all smaller than 1, then it is very easy to reach a number which is so close to 0 that numerically on the computer it is exactly 0 due to rounding errors. So if you do that, the only way to make that work is to write a logarithm. So we have curly L of h with the data x1 up to xn is log of the likelihood data x1 up to xn. And that is, by the rules of the logarithm, the product comes out as the sum. And then we have the logarithm of f hat h I xi. And this quantity, the log likelihood, has, of course, different values than the likelihood, because one is the log of the other. But the point is, log is a monotonic function. So this one takes its maximum for the same h as that one does. So to find the h, just maximize this. And it turns out numerically that is much, much, much more stable. So the logarithm of a small number is still a reasonable number. And if we add n reasonable numbers, we are still having a reasonable number. And it turns out if you do that, it often does not work. Whereas if you do that, it works. And again, you need to use numerical maximization to find the best h. And you need to be a bit careful because there may be local maxima. So you need to do a grid search again. And then from the best grid point, you can maximize it a bit further if you want by using some gradient-based method. Okay, there is this. And in the notes, I also describe an alternative method, which is popular in the literature, but to me looks slightly obscure, so I'm not going to explain that here and leave it for you to read up in the notes. Good, and that's what I wanted to tell you about here. So what you should do now is you should go back to the notes and read through this again and make sure you get all the details. And then I'm aware we have not done many examples here, so I'll fix this in next week's video, coming in a few days, where I will do mostly examples. Okay, so thank you and see you soon.